I love inhaling helium. It makes your voice sound hilarious.
But have you ever wondered why your voice sounds ridiculous? It turns out it all has to do with the speed of sound. Helium is a very light atom, and so sound actually travels 3 times faster through it. That makes your frequency of your sound waves 3 times higher, and so your pitch is higher. Okay, if you understood all of that, you're some sort of physics genius. So let's slow that down, break it down, and understand sound waves and helium a little more deeply. Well, let's get started. Let's review our lesson objectives. First, we'll explain how sound waves are produced. Then we'll consider how amplitude and frequency impact sound waves. Then we'll learn to calculate the frequency of sound. Stringed instruments are amazing, and they come in all shapes and sizes and make all sorts of different sounds. But when you think about it, why do they make sound at all? Why does plucking a string make a sound? Well, here's a close-up of a string that's been plucked. It's vibrating back and forth. Right now, it's swinging to the right. That's what that arrow is showing. And as it swings to the right, it compresses the air molecules in front of that. We call that compression, sensibly enough. Behind it, the gas molecules get decompressed. They get farther apart. And in nerd speak, we call that rarefaction. That's where the gas molecules are getting farther apart, and on the front, they're getting closer together. And that actually just is what sound is, a series of compressed and decompressed airwaves. Speakers work just the same way. They vibrate at the right frequencies at just the right time to push air together, which we call compression, and to pull air back, which we call rarefaction. Just so you can picture it a little more clearly, here's what happens when you put sand on top of the speaker. This is basically what happens to the air molecules. They get pushed forward together over and over again. Here's an actual image of those air molecules. You can see that in some cases, they're slammed together. We call that compression. So those blue spheres represent our air molecules, and sometimes they pile up. On the other hand, when there's not many air molecules, we call that rarefaction. The distance between the two compressed peaks, we call the wavelength. So just like all of our waves, sound waves have a wavelength. This is just like our slinky that we saw a few lessons back. If we move our hand back and forth, we'll create a series of compressions and a series of expansions or rarefactions. Now, here's the thing. What sort of wave is this? Well, this is a longitudinal wave, and that's what sound waves are. Sound waves are longitudinal waves. The tricky thing about longitudinal waves, like sound, is that it can be kind of hard to picture the wavelength. Here, we've pointed out that wavelength is from compression to compression, where those gas molecules are close together to where they're close together again. It's even harder to picture amplitude. So what we do oftentimes is we map a longitudinal wave onto a transverse wave like this. So we can kind of represent it with a transverse wave, where every peak you see is where we've reached that maximum in compression. And the amplitude is going to indicate how strong of a compression we had. So for the rest of our lesson, we'll picture it that way, just because it's easier to talk about. So remember that stronger compression means higher amplitude. Well, what does amplitude do for sound and how we experience it? Well, take this little mouse here on the left. He creates a low amplitude sound wave. So we experience that as being quite quiet. The compressions are not very strong. The megaphone on the right, on the other hand, creates an enormous compression, which gives us a high amplitude and a loud sound. So remember that amplitude determines volume. Speaking of something loud, what about lightning? Lightning creates a huge thunderclap, and it is extremely loud. We know, though, that as we get farther away from the lightning, that sound gets quieter. And that's because amplitude decreases with distance. Another thing we notice when we look at lightning is that there's very often a gap between when we see the lightning and when we hear it. And that's because sound takes time to travel. Sound takes time to travel. And it's fast, but it's not nearly as fast as light, as we'll see later. How fast is sound? Well, in air, it travels 740 miles per hour. Okay, so, you know, very fast. But compared to the speed of light, it's nothing. And so as we get farther from the lightning, then we notice that the gap between the light and the sound gets longer and longer. Okay, there's a relationship, though, between the speed at which our sound moves and the frequency. The faster sound travels, the higher the frequency. Now, let's recall what frequency is. Frequency is a measure of how often a peak passes a given point per second. To understand its relationship to speed, let's take a look at another series of sound waves. Here, we've shown them clearly as longitudinal waves with compressions and rarefactions. The sound waves are traveling from the speaker to the ear. Now, how fast that wave moves changes how often there are peaks. The faster the wave, the more frequent there are peaks. So what that means is the faster sound travels, the higher the frequency. Okay, well, how do we experience frequency? We said we experience amplitude as the volume. Well, it turns out the frequency is experienced as pitch. So when we take a very large stringed instrument, it's relatively low frequency and relatively low pitch. When we make our stringed instrument smaller, then it's going to have a higher frequency and a higher pitch. So remember that high frequency sounds give us a high pitch sound. Well, let's put that together to understand my awesome helium voice at the beginning of this lesson. In air, remember that my speed of sound is 740 miles per hour. In helium, though, 2,200 miles per hour. It's traveling three times faster. And that's going to impact the frequency and hence the pitch. Let's look at our equation to determine frequency from the velocity of sound. Here's the velocity of sound. Now you can just ignore everything else in this equation. Don't worry about the little weird wavelength thing here. We'll come back to that in a second. Instead, just focus on velocity. If I triple the velocity, that's going to triple the frequency and change the pitch. Okay, let's go through this equation more carefully, and then we'll actually use it to calculate frequency in the case of different velocities. As I said, this is the symbol for wavelength. It's the Greek letter lambda. We're always going to put wavelength in meters, just as we're always going to put velocity in meters per second. When you combine meters per second and you divide by meters, you're going to get the frequency in hertz, which is the same thing as per second. So frequency is measured in hertz, and remember, that's the same thing as per second. So here are a number of waves, two waves we're taking a look at, and they have a series of peaks across 1 second of time. Notice that the one on the left has about three peaks, so that would have a frequency of about 3 hertz, whereas the one on the right has many, many more peaks, so it's going to have a higher frequency. Another thing you might notice here is that the one on the left is relatively long in wavelength, and the one on the right has a relatively short wavelength. And that's just true. When you have a short wavelength, you tend to get a higher frequency. So remember that small wavelengths give you high frequency. This is called an inverse relationship. As wavelength gets bigger, frequency gets smaller. As wavelength gets smaller, frequency gets higher. All right, let's put this equation into practice. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at how frequency, wavelength, and velocity all relate. Here we're told that a typical female singer produces sound waves with a wavelength of 1.5 meters. That means that the distance between those peak compressions is 1.5 meters. Given she has just inhaled air, where we're told the velocity of sound is 331 meters per second, what is the frequency of her voice? So we are looking for frequency. We want to know what is the frequency. And we've been given a few variables here. First up, we've been given wavelength, which we represent with that Greek letter lambda, of 1.5 meters. Then we've also been told the velocity of our wave. In air, sound moves at 331 meters per second. So all we need to do then is recall that our equation tells us that frequency is equal to the velocity divided by the wavelength. Here, notice that our wavelength and our velocity already have the units of meters. If they didn't match, we'd have to make them match, but here they do, so we're ready to just plug them in to our equation. We do 331 divided by 1.5. That gives us a frequency of 220.6, and that 6 actually repeats for a while. But we're going to need to round for sig figs. We have 2 sig figs in our wavelength, so we want to keep 2. So that means we're going to get 220 for our frequency. What units do we use? Well, hertz. So that should be Hz. Remember that that means 220 times a second. What that's basically saying is if you're standing there listening to this singer, you'll experience a peak in compression of that wavelength 220 times a second. Now it's your turn to give this a try. A typical female singer produces sound waves with a wavelength of 1.5 meters. Given that she has just inhaled helium, velocity equals 983 meters per second, what is the frequency of her voice? So now we'll take a look at what happens to frequency in helium. Pause the video and see if you can calculate the frequency. The frequency should be 660 hertz. Notice this is a much higher frequency than the one we calculated previously, and so this will make the pitch of the voice much higher. Let's review what we've learned. First, we explained how sound waves are produced. Things like strings or speakers vibrate, creating a series of compressions and a series of rarefactions. Then we consider how amplitude and frequency impact sound waves. Amplitude impacts the volume, and frequency impacts the pitch. And lastly, we learned to calculate the frequency of sound. Hey, hey.